योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचाम् मलम् शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तम् प्रवरम् मुनीनाम् पतञ्जलिम् प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि आबाहु पुरुषाकारम् शङ्खचक्रासिधारिणम् सहस्रशिरसं श्वेतम् प्रणमामि पतञ्जलिम् गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुः साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः हरिः ओम् सो लास्ट् टैम् वि स्टार्टेड् आन् सूत्र 2.13 एण्ड् वि कवर्ड् द बिगिनिङ्ग् आफ् द भाष्य एण्ड् लैक् ऐ सेड् इट्स् अ लाङ्ग् भाष्य and an extremely interesting one because it gives the exact mechanisms in which the karmas operate. So we'll continue that from where we left off last time. So the sutra was sati mule tad vipako jatyayur bhogaha, and in a nutshell what we covered was as long as the husk in the form of karmashayas exist, or as long as the seed is not burned by the fire of prasankhyanam or viveka khyati, while that is the state, and only when that is the state, the karmashaya, which is the collection of karmas, will fructify into three things: birth, life and lifespan, and life experiences, jati, ayuh, bhogaha. Then we saw some discussion of this in the bhashya, and we looked at certain alternatives to understand how the karmas and karmashaya's fructification operates. I also gave some background on why this had to be done. Why look at these alternatives? Because the fruit of different karmas are different, and sometimes different karmas might have contradictory fruits. One may say that sthavaratam gacchati naraha, so this leads to life as a unmoving organism like a tree, whereas something else might say vachikaihi pakshimrugatam, this leads to a life as a bird or an animal, and so on. So how are these contradictions to be resolved? That is one of the main questions to be answered. And we looked at, there are four alternatives considered, and three were considered in our last session and disposed of by Vyasa. The three were whether one karma leads to one life, one karma leads to many lives, or many karmas together lead to many lives. These three were disposed of. So that leaves us with one alternative, which has not yet been considered, which is many karmas leading to one life and lifespan. So does that mean that is the solution to the problem, that many karmas can lead to one life and lifespan? So the answer is no, because it cannot be as straightforward as that. Now, why? Because that answer does not answer the possible contradictions, which was the problem that we set out to solve. If many karmas lead to one lifespan, what about the contradictory fruits, and how can they all coexist at the same time? Secondly, it is well known that karmas and their fructification is a mysterious concept, not easily understood. Bhagavad Gita also says, Gahana Karmano Gatihi. So the karmas and their journey to fructification is something which is difficult to understand, which is mysterious. So if that is the case, the fourth alternative that says many karmas lead to one life is not the answer by itself. It is not as simple as that, and we need to have an answer that can solve all the questions and also explain why the gahana karmano gatihi, why things are not easy to predict. And Vyasa sets out to do that beautifully, starting with the taking the fourth alternative and adding the nuances that will then explain how things work. So now we can start on the remaining part of the Vyasa Bhashya. Okay. So Vyasa
says, I will add something. It is to be understood that there is one and the same baggage of karmas, the body of karmas, body of prarabdha, which will result into jati, ayu and bhoga. It is not that there is one body of karmas or prarabdha for jati, that is birth, another body of karmas for ayu or lifespan, and another body of karmas for experiences in life, sukha, dukkha, moha. It is one and the same body of karmas from where threefold bhushans take place. Threefold or three kinds of fruits. One is giving, the other one giving lifespan, and the third one giving experiences. So it should be understood that there are no different sets of karmas as substrate or baggage for each of these three. It is one and the same body of karmas for all these three. That's called prarabdha. The prarabdha will give the mapping for all the three. When, where, how, in what condition someone will take birth, what kind of birth, and then the lifespan, shorter lifespan or longer lifespan, and then experiences in the form of sukha, dukkha, moha, mild pleasures to huge mountainous pleasures, similarly about pains, sorrows, and similarly about moha. So it should be understood that prarabdha body is one and the same for all the three kinds of fructifications in the form of jati, ayu, and bhoga. Okay?
Yes. So let's look at Vyasa now continues. He says, Tasmat janma prayanantare krutaha punya punya karmashaya prachayaha vichitraha pradhanopasarjana bhavena avasthitaha prayanabhivyakta eka prakattakena militva maranam prasadhya sammurchita ekameva janma karoti. He says, therefore means having seen and disposed of the other three alternatives, therefore the one remaining, janma prayanantare, between the birth and death, that is throughout the life, krutaha punya punya karmashaya prachayaha. So whatever punya apunya, so virtuous and non-virtuous or sinful, the dharma adharma, so all the actions, karmas, done in the life since between birth and death, whatever has arisen from that, prachayaha, so the karmashaya that has arisen from that, vichitraha, highly variegated, of various kinds, pradhanopasarjana bhavena. Okay, so now this is something to pay attention to. So this gets taken as pradhana and upasarjana, something that is primary and the rest that are secondary. So pradhana upasarjana bhavena avasthitaha, being in that state, prayana vyaktaha, so that manifests death. Okay, so what does this karmashaya do when it fructifies? So abhivyanjanam, abhivyaktihi of, so manifestation of death, that is this life is brought to an end by the karmashaya that has been collected by actions during the lifespan, so that the fructification can begin with jati, ayu, bhoga, with birth lifespan and life experiences for the next life can now begin, and therefore this karmashaya operates, the karmashaya collected operates by manifesting death. Eka pragattakena militva. So all these vichitra, variegated karmas come together as though one single lump. So they get together as though one single lump. Maranam prasadya, having given death, ekameva janma karoti. They lead to one birth alone. So this is firstly, Vyasa begins by establishing the fourth alternative, or actually it was probably the third alternative, or the remaining alternative, which says the various karmas done between birth and death, that is during the life, of punya, apunya nature, highly variegated nature, will now come together to form as though one lump, with a classification of primary and secondary within that, manifesting death so that it opens the door to the fructification through a new birth and a new lifespan. And it leads to, all of this leads to one birth only. Ekameva janma karoti. So that is how all the actions done in one lifespan is leading to a new birth. Now he says, tatcha janma, and this birth, or tenaiva karmana. So this birth, the new birth, is coming only because of those karmas. Right? So the karmas in the current life, now there are karmas that is there from like time without end, time without beginning, and so on, that we have seen. But here specifically it is being said that the karmas done in the current birth, between birth and death, they come together. There is a classification of primary, secondary, leading to one life, one new birth only. And that birth, tena eva karmana labdha yushkam bhavati. So that birth has come about by those karmas alone. Tasmin ayushi. Now in that new birth, in that new life, tena eva karmana bhogaha sampadyate. By those karmas alone, there is life experiences. Asau karmashayaha. So this karmashaya, janma ayur bhoga hetutvat trivipako abhidhiyate iti. So when this happens, so now what has happened is, between birth and death, highly varied set of karmas have been done. Those karmas come together as a lump, or come together, then there is a primary secondary determination. Based on that, the nature of the next birth is decided. But for that to happen, this birth has to end through by manifestation of death. Then the new birth gets decided through this particular lump and primary secondary alone. The new birth, its lifespan, labdha ayushkam, how long the next birth will be, and what are the bhogas? What are the type of the bhogas? Because once again, as described last time, free will does not go away. And we'll see that as we go further. So the type of the bhogas, or the life experiences for the upcoming birth, also is determined by these sets of karmas alone. And therefore, this karmashaya, which has led to a new birth, lifespan and experiences, is known as trivibhaka. Trivipaka means three means three. Vipaka means fruition. Since this fruition of the nature of three things, jati, ayur, bhoga, this is known as trivipaka karmashaya. Ataha ekabhavika karmashaya ukta iti. And therefore it is ekabhavika, in the sense that this entire karmashaya that we talked about has led to one new life with its birth, life experiences, and birth, lifespan, and life experiences. So this is the first introduction into how the fourth alternative, not only the fact that it is fourth alternative, but how the variety of karmas is being taken into account. And we have seen part of it, how the variety of karmas have been taken into account through this coming together and primary secondary classification and how that is leading to a new birth. Now there is more to see, but this at this point Vyasa is establishing why it is Trivipaka and why it is Eka Bhavika Karma Ashaya.
So the fourth option has been advocated or held as valid. Now it is not that we have to believe because the authority says that the fourth option is only right option. There is enormous logic behind that postulation, and there is also experience. We will also experience that it is real, it is true, that our life is launched on huge body of several karmas. That is why in our life we experience sometimes unexpected and unforeseen failures in our life on one hand. And on the other hand, we will get success, thumping success, unexpected success, huge success. So we experience in one life several kinds of fruits, very, very bitter fruits, very, very sweet fruits, and everything between the very bitter and very sweet. So we experience several kinds of fruits in our life in the form of failure and success and delights and pleasures and fortunes and misfortunes. See, many times, if you objectively look at your own life, sometimes you feel, wherever you have taken birth, you say, I am fortunate to take having taken birth in this family. At one point in time, you would say that. At another point in time, you would say that I should have taken birth in some other family. I am fortunate to be born in this family. And on the other hand, sometimes you will say, I am not fortunate to have taken birth in this family. I should have taken in some other fortunate house. So we experience all kinds of experiences in our one life. Fortune to misfortune, to failure, to success, to sorrows, to delights, etc., etc. So we have the fruits of our life are multi-tasted or multi-tasting. It's not that we have only one kind of taste in our life. Several kinds of tastes are there. If there are several kinds of tastes, it cannot be just one karma. It has to be variegated body of karmas, several kinds of karmas, huge body of karmas, to give us the pains of every degree, pleasures of every degree, success of every degree, failure of every degree, fortune of every degree, misfortune of every degree. So several fruits are being endured by us in our one lifetime. This cannot be fruit of one karma. This has to be huge body of karmas, of all sorts of karmas. Therefore, we have colorful life. So therefore, that's the logic behind postulating that there are several karmas resulting into one life. Now you can assess the other options, how they are not logical and how they are not truth bearing. There is a lot of faults, or there are a lot of flaws if you consider other options in the light of this. Do we get life of one experience and die? Do we have only one kind of experience throughout the life? One class of experience throughout the life? No, that's not the thing. Our life is very, very, very colorful. Countless colors are there. Therefore, it is certain that the underlying body of karmas is huge body of karmas, several karmas, punyas and papas, the vices and virtues of every degree, meager degree to very, very, very potent, strong degrees. That's why we have colorful life, every kind of experience we get. That is why we can find logic, reasoning, and also our experience, which will advocate the fourth option that Vyasa has mentioned. So then he mentions the technical term of Eka Bhavika Karmashaya. That means Eka Bhava, in one birth, we commit so many kinds of karmas. And therefore, all the karmas have different kinds of fruits. So the karmashaya, which is earned in one life, which is considered between the lifespan, birth to death, and then final balance sheet is drawn, and then the body of karmas is allocated for next manifestation, and that's therefore we get this kind of experience. Therefore, many karmas account for one life. We don't severally exist in one life. So there is also not right to say that many karmas and many lives. No, simultaneously we don't exist in many, many manifestations. Therefore, we have one life, one birth, one body of experience, one body of vasana, fructification, that is based on several karmas. Okay.
Now, Vyasa proceeds to first give two clarifications, because having heard this, there may be certain questions that might come to mind. So the first is, okay, so this is Trivipaka Karmashaya, because the fruit is of three kinds, Jati, Ayu and Bhoga. What are the others? So there he says, Drishta Janma Vedaniyahatu Eka Vipaka Arambhi Bhoga Hetutvat. So the Drishta Janma Vedaniya means the karmas that were done in this life and got fructified also in the same life. Right? So this we saw in the previous sutra, that this can happen if the karmas are of highly virtuous nature or highly sinful nature. Then they will immediately fructify. So their fructification is only on terms of experience. Bhoga hetutva, bhoga only. And therefore it is eka vipaka arambhi. It leads to one kind, begins a one kind of a fruition. So that is the eka vipaka arambhi. Then dvivipakarambhiva bhogayur hetutvat nandishwaravat nahushavat va iti. So the other one, the dvivipakarambhi, is of bhoga and ayu. So there is no birth, there is no janma. This is similar to that of Nandishwara and Nahusha. So we heard the stories also in the session before the previous one, where they got transformed, you know, in a different state of existence. So Nandishwara turned from a boy to the head of Shiva's ganas in the form of a bull without having to undergo a birth. But he has a ayu and bhoga. So that is a dvivipaka. Similarly, Nahusha, who was the king of the devas at the time, got turned into a snake without having to have undergone birth. So again, it is ayu and bhoga, and therefore it is dvivipaka, dvivipaka arambhi. So that is the first clarification that Vyasa has given. So we have seen trivipaka, but also ekavipaka and dvivipaka. Then the other question that might come is, okay, the actions of the current life between birth and death decide the next life's janma, ayu and bhoga. But what about all the other actions that have been there from the time without beginning, which we have been hearing about? So what about those? So there Vyasa says, klesha karma vipakanubhava nirvartita bhi tu vasana bhi anadikala sammurchitam idam chittam. So okay, what is the nature of the chitta? It is of the following nature: klesha karma vipaka anubhava nirvartita. Okay, so what are these? This is a description of nirvartita bhi tu vasana bhi. So these are vasanas. So vasanas are of this kind: klesha karma vipaka anubhava. The kleshas, the karma, their fruition, the experience of that fruition, and having gone through this over and over, those vasanas, and by those vasanas, anadikala sammurchitam idam chittam. The chitta has been undergoing the effects of these types of vasanas from time without beginning. And the vasanas are of what kind? It is the same thing. Klesha karma vipaka anubhava nirvartita. So since time without beginning, there has been this klesha, karma, fruition, experience leading to vasanas. And the chitta, which is, it is the same chitta with the same purusha as we have seen in the first chapter. So that chitta has been undergoing that. The vasanas in the chitta have been putting chitta in that condition. Chitri krutam iva. So that chitta is like spotted, variegated, variously colored. Okay, by all of these vasanas, sarvataha matsya jalam granti bihi iva atatam ityetaha aneka bhavapurvikaha vasanaha. So here now there are multiple things. So this chitta has had to undergo these vasanas. By that, it is spotted, variegated, highly colored by all these different types of vasanas. And like a matsya jalam means fisherman's net. Like a fishing net, granthi bihi, with these knots. Okay, the concept of granthi is another deep concept which comes in Upanishads, Vedanta Upanishads, Yoga Upanishads, and everywhere. So there are these granthis in the chitta, there are these knots, and there are so many knots because of so many vasanas of so many kinds. And it is as though, okay, it is not literally, the chitta is not literally in the form of the net. So that is not how one should conceive the chitta to be. It is not a physically a net, but granthi bihi iva, as though, atatam, completely covered from all sides. Ityetaha, these aneka bhavapurvika. So now this is interesting because Vyasa just established that the karmashaya is ekabhavika. Okay, so the entire karmashaya is leading to one new life, one new manifestation. Whereas it is these vasanas which are aneka bhavapurvika vasanaha. So this is the clarification that we were looking for. So this principle now beautifully combines or synthesizes the effect of karmas from various lives since time without beginning on the same chitta through the operation of vasanas and the manifestation of a new birth or a new lifespan, which happens by means of the karmas in the previous birth getting together, being categorized into primary and secondary and giving rise to one kind of birth, life experiences and lifespan. So both of these have come together, and therefore these are the nuances that we were referring to, where all things can be explained, including contradictions and all the doubts that may come to mind through the operation of these multiple mechanisms happening all at the same time. So these are aneka bhava purvikaha vasanaha yastu ayam karmashaya esha eva eka bhavika ukta iti. So he clarifies that it is only this karmashaya, that is the karmashaya collected between a given birth and death, that is in a given life, only that esha eva. So Vyasa is taking care to make things clear. He's saying esha eva Eka bhavika ukta. It is not as though everything is eka bhavika. The vasanas are not eka bhavika. They are aneka bhava purvika. But this particular karmashaya that Vyasa referred to just earlier in the explanation of the alternative that he has accepted, that one only is eka bhavika. Esha eva eka bhavika ukta iti. Only this has been referred by me, says Vyasa, as eka bhavika. ये संस्काराः स्मृतिहेतवाः ताः वासनाः ताः च अनादिकालीना इति. However, the samskaras which lead to smriti, which lead to smriti arising. Smriti is memory but not exactly memory, and we have seen that in detail. But the samskaras that give rise to mental states, which is referred to smriti and memory, and the vasanas which lead to tendencies, those are anadikalina. They are from built from time without beginning. And that has now, I mean, these two concepts, the Eka Bhavika Karmashaya leading to a next birth, lifespan, life experiences, and the Anadikalika Vasanas leading to smritis, so the mental, certain mental states, memories and tendencies through the operation of Vasanas, both are operating together to explain how the karma and the world works. So here we have seen sort of the first detailed nuance, and there is more to come. But here let us understand the difference between Eka Bhavika and the Aneka Bhavapurvika Anadikala, the nature of Karmashaya and the Vasanas respectively.
So let us consider sort of certain technical terms which have come in the commentary just now you heard. Eka Bhavika Karmashaya. That means the body of karma is which gives one life, lifespan, etc. So also, it also Eka Vipakaram Bhi. It's just now heard that certain karma which we do now in this life, we bear out the fruit in this life itself. We don't have to wait for next life and another life. So fructification takes place here itself, which is called Sopakrama Karma kind of thing. So, suppose we have done a karma, it doesn't mean we have to now take another birth and experience that fruit. In the very lifespan, we will be experiencing that fruit. In the very same life, we have committed karma in this life because of our free will. And we will be experiencing the fruit in the, this life itself. There is only bhoga aspect of it. We don't have to again take another birth for it and have another lifespan for it. Just the bhoga. So that becomes Eka Vipakaram Bhi Karmashaya. We don't have to wait for another life, a birth and another lifespan. In very life, this lifespan, we will be experiencing the bhoga of the karmas which are committed in this karma because of its power, potency and nature of the karma. Some karmas are sopakrama, they start fructification right from the commitment of the karma or commission to karma. So that is Eka Vipakaram Bhi, means it will only have bhoga. You don't have to take another birth. You don't have to have another lifespan. Then there is Vipakaram Bhi Karmashaya. This is also very much we can be seeing in this, our world itself. Sometimes a child takes birth. But the child is not a still child, or sometimes it is only a still child, means it is Eka Bhavika. The birth has taken place, but a still child was born, or the child died within a couple of minutes. So it only had that Eka Vipakaram Bhi Karmashaya. Just taking birth and going away. Then there is Vipakaram Bhi Karmashaya. Where there is life and lifespan, but no bhoga. The child takes birth. The child is not still. It's not still, child is born. But however, the child doesn't come to consciousness. It is living. Heart is beating. Breathing is taking place. So, the child has no bhoga. It doesn't experience anything in this world. However, it has a lifespan. It might live for a couple of days, couple of weeks, couple of months, and sometimes even years. So that is Vipakaram Bhi Karmashaya. That is also possible, and we see in the world around us that it is possible that can be Eka Vipakaram Bhi Karmashaya, there can be Dvivipakaram Bhi Karmashaya. And the three Vipakaram Bhi is the one which is of all of us generality. We take a birth, we have a lifespan, we have experiences. So Eka Vipakaram Bhi, Dvivipakaram Bhi, Trivipakaram Bhi can be also seen in our world and the world around us. Then he says, Aneka Bhava Purvika Vasana. The vasanas, which are substrate of our karmashaya, are collected from countless and several lives, almost countless lives from time without beginning. So that has to be understood, that the vasanas which constitute the karmashaya are collected from several lives. Whereas one body of karmashaya gives us one set of trivipakarambhi karmashaya. So this is another point to be noted. Now, you just now heard that there are several kinds of, you know, the granthis are the knots of vasanas. We have several kinds of vasanas. One is called vasana, karma vasana. Like, I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to learn this, I want to learn that, I want to try this, I want to try that. So we have the motivation for doing something. So that is karma vasana. The other one are our tendencies. They are innate in us. And we have such certain tendencies which come up. We can't even resist it. Whether we want it or don't want it, they are going to surface. So there are vasanas, body, the tendency aspects, which are innately within us. We don't decide and do something. We do it. We are made to do it impulsively or quite spontaneously. So there is karma vasana. And then there is just vasana of the nature of tendencies. And the third one is phala vasana. We also have phala vasana. I must have that. I must have that pleasure. I must have that experience. So there is karma vasana, vasana, and phala vasana. So these are the particular classification of vasanas. There are several classifications of vasanas which we'll understand in due course. But with reference to this sutra here, karmashaya, we have to understand that we have these three kinds of tendencies. One is I want to do, and then something is quite a part of tendency of mine. Therefore, it manifests, it springs forth, it comes up. The third one is phala vasana. I want to have certain experiences. I want to experience richness. I want to experience recognition, name, fame, etc., popularity. I want to experience a kind of something. So we have phala vasana also. And therefore, the vasanas become so complicated. Vasanas to do, vasanas to have, vasanas to experience. And there are so many kinds of vasanas. As I said, we'll look at them in due course. But that's why it is variegated kind of granthis. Jala. Jala means which just arrests ourselves. So it's an arrestation. When we want to do something, it's an arrestation. We can't resist it. By hook or crook, we'll try it, and then if some impulse will come and we'll do it. A certain vasanas are coming spontaneously, unknowingly. We are not able to take cognizance of it. They will just manifest and play out their role. And the third one is phala vasana, because we experience other world around us. We can imagine the experience of birds. So we think I should fly. I should be able to fly. So we see the experience of other people, rich people, affluent people, successful people, and then we feel that I should be like that. I should get that. Phala vasana. So the vasanas are beautifully described in Adhyatma Shastra. There are several classifications of vasanas. This is one of the such classifications which is quite relevant to this sutra here. Okay.
So now, having understood the karma shaya and that results in the next birth, as well as how vasanas are bringing in the other effect from the time without beginning on the chitta, now we look closer into the karmashaya. Okay. So Vyasa says, यस्तु असौ एकभविकः कर्माशयः च नियतविपाकः च अनियतविपाकश्च. सो नाउ वी आर लुकिंग क्लोजर इन टू दिस पर्टिक्युलर कर्माशय विच इज गिविंग आफ्टर बीइंग कमिंग टुगेदर विथ प्राइमरी एंड सेकेंडरी एंड सो ऑन. दिस पर्टिक्युलर कर्माशय अगेन हैज टू एस्पेक्ट्स टू इट विच इज नियत विपाकः एंड अनियत विपाकः. And we'll see what that is. But niyata as in fixed, okay? Sort of a fixed,
appointed by time, appointed by time,
predictable, appointed by time, right? Very regular. So niyata vipaka, that is fruition, which is well determined, appointed by time, and aniyata vipaka, fruition which is not of that nature. So now tatra adrishta janma vedaniyah vedaniyasya niyata vipakasya eva ayam niyamah natu adrishta janma vedaniyasya aniyata vipakasya. So now this niyama, okay, which niyama are we talking about? Eka bhavikatva niyamah. Okay, so the thing that leads to one particular new jati ayu bhoga, that niyama applies to which one? The niyata vipaka. But to be very clear, it is the adrishta janma vedaniyasya niyata vipakasya. Why? Because the drishta janma vedaniya is something where the karma and the fruition all is happening in the same life. So that is not what we are looking at here. We are looking at adrishta janma vedaniya. So once that is understood, we'll take that as the context. So context for all of this is adrishta janma vedaniya. Here, the eka bhavikatva niyama, okay, that is the niyama that all of this is leading to one new life span and experience, one that applies to the niyata vipaka aspect, or those that are that part of the karmashaya which is niyata vipaka, where the fruition is, as he said, appointed by time. And that niyama, which niyama? The eka bhavikatva niyama does not apply to the aniyata vipaka. So that part of the karmashaya whose fruition is not appointed by time, is not sort of predictable, well determined, predetermined, that sort of thing. So it is not appointed by time. For them, the eka bhavikatva niyama does not apply. Kasmat, okay, so how come? Yohi adrishta janma vedaniyah aniyata vipakah tasya trayi gatihi. So now this is getting even more interesting and involved. So we have seen the niyata vipaka, because that is what we said get classified into primary and secondary and gives rise to a new birth, lifespan and life experiences. So that is done. But now a new concept is being introduced, the aniyata vipaka. So though that part of the karmashaya whose fruition is not well appointed by time, so that it is not as per that eka bhavikatva rule. Okay, so how come? What about those? So tesham trayi gatihi. So their final result is of three types. So now we see the three types. Krutasya avipakvasya nashaha. Okay, so whatever has been done but has not yet fructified, that may get destroyed. Okay, nashaha means destruction, goes away. So krutasya avipakvasya nashaha, which means nashaha means it does not disappear, it goes into a form where it cannot fructify. Okay, because as we have seen in Sankhya Yoga, nothing sort of goes away out of the blue, completely disappears. It is rendered impotent. So krutasya avipakvasya nashaha. Then second one. Pradhana karmani avapagamanam va. So into some pradhana karma, this gets sort of mixed, scattered, mixed and dissolved. So it gets, there is a word called antarbhutaha. So it gets absorbed or mixed into some other pradhana karma. So its fructification is in some sense attenuated because it happens as part of some other pradhana karma or the pradhana karma of the karmashaya. So pradhana upasarjana niyata vipaka are already been determined. So as an example, which I think is also in the book, Prashant's book, where I think it says, there may be something good that happens. So like you win a lottery, but there was this aniyata vipaka where something bad was going to happen. So a small bad thing happens when you carry that amount, you trip and fall or something, but you don't feel bad. So the experiences is not damaging because it has been absorbed into some other pradhana karma. So the winning a lottery has such a big effect that the other small mishap is not something you would notice. So pradhana karmani avapagamanam is the other example. Then niyata vipaka pradhana karmanabhibhutasyava chiram avasthanam. So this one, it says niyata vipaka pradhana karmana abhibhutasya chiram avasthanam, means so the pradhana, it is sort of suppressed by the primary karma of the karmashaya, which is niyata vipaka, which means it's the karmashaya, which is ekabhavika, is well appointed and it has jati ayurbhoga, and in that, by that pradhana karma, it is suppressed and therefore it lies about for a long time. Chiram avasthanam, which means it may not fructify in the next life. It may not fructify in the life after the next life. So it may just lie around until the conditions that will lead it to manifest. So maybe the condition is a different birth as a different organism or whatever. So until that particular condition comes about, it will lie suppressed. And when that manifesting condition comes, then it may arise. So this is so these three together comprise the gati of the aniyata vipaka. One is the nasha, kratasya avipakvasya nashaha. Second is pradhana karmani avapagamanam, so being absorbed or associated and taken into some other pradhana karma. Or third is it is lying around for a long time, chiram avasthanam, until it gets manifested by the proper conditions of that pradhana karma of that particular, leading to that particular life. So it may give manifest at some other time in the future, not when the karmashaya is mainly operating in the next life. So now we will see all of these one by one. So these are the three gatis of the niyata vipaka and aniyata vipaka, which is a very interesting classification of the karmashaya. So vasana is a separate thing, which was aneka bhavika and anadikalika. Then this karmashaya was said to be only eka bhavika, with pradhana upasarjana. Now there a further nuance has been brought in by bringing in niyata vipaka and aniyata vipaka. The niyata vipaka is well understood because it is all covered in the life that is to come. Aniyata vipaka is even slightly more mysterious because there are three types or three ways in which they will come about. They may either get destroyed or get mixed into some other pradhana karma or be suppressed for a long time, that is multiple lives, until they rise up again.
So here we are again coming across some technical terms. Basically, first one, pair of niyata vipaka, aniyata vipaka. So niyata vipaka means appointed by time, place, space, condition, etc. What we call as destiny. And we know that it cannot be avoided, averted. So the time, place, situation, condition are decided. And that is niyata vipaka, regulated kind of fruition. It is regulated where, when, how it will take place. That is why it is called Niyata Vipaka. While the other class is Aniyata Vipaka. Aniyata means not appointed by time. Now, in case of Niyata Vipaka, when it is appointed by time, place, space, etc., there can be a postponement. This is aspect of karma management, which yogis are privileged. The spiritually evolved people have this kind of privilege that they can carry out karma management. That's why, if you recall, I had said earlier that karma siddhanta is not really fatalistic kind of theory. The free will is there for mankind. It's not only free will to do the karmas, but even free will to experience the fruitions. But this is for exalted people, they can have this. So postponement is one management aspect, karma management aspect. The karmas, karma phala, can be postponed by a yogi or even one who is spiritually evolved. Now, this is a great facility. Rather than taking the karmas as and when they will fructify, if you have this arrangement that you can predate them or postdate them, you can change the appointment. So, changing the appointment is only applicable to Niyata Karmashaya. There is nothing that kind of thing for Aniyata Vipaka, which is not at all appointed by time. You can't say there is a postponement. So it must be appointed by time. So when it is appointed by time and etc., that can be postponed or even preponed. So this is a great privilege to spiritually evolved people. They can be doing this. Not the mortals like you and me. But after a little evolution of consciousness, this is possible. So, Niyata Karma Karmashaya, Niyata Vipaka Karmashaya, can have postponement. Or there is karma management of the nature of combining with a major desirable fruit. See, now, just now you heard the example that you won a raffle, you won a lottery, and on your way back you had a mishap. But in case of a yogi, he can postpone any such thing also. He can arrange it for some other time. If it is not avoidable, he will be able to manage it and not spoil his experience also. Our experience is also not spoiled because we have won a raffle of 100 million rupees, sold a fall here and there and little bruise here and there. It really doesn't bother us. But in case of management, yogi can do it. And the third one is to send it to cold storage. Yes, you can't be avoiding the karmas, you can't be avoiding the fruition. But then there is also possibility of sending that body of karmas into cold storage for long time. So you can be doing good karmas in such a successive process that you don't allow the bad karmas to fructify. This is also possible for we mortals. If you go on doing powerful good karmas, then negative karmas will not find a way to get in. So the karma can be carried out by even mortals like us, whereby we will be able to carry out some kind of management of our karmas. But if they find the little hole somewhere, they will just creep in and they will spoil our experience. So karma management is something where we are told about there is a free will. But not only whether to do or whether not to do, in case of exalted people, is also fruition, whether I should take the fruit now or at later point in time. And perhaps you can have cumulative benefits also. So they can postpone the fruitions of karmas. Now there are the examples, I will just give you one example. I may not be having in my destiny, but I can be getting that karma. Now, this is quite intriguing and illogical for we people who are just thinking temporally and empirically. But for spiritually realized people, it is possible. I'll just give you one story here. It's a story which happened in life of Sai Baba. He was in the habit of sitting with fires on all four sides around him. I am speaking about Shirdi Sai Baba. About 150 years back, 100 years back, he lived. He was keeping fire on all the sides. And every time, whenever he was sitting, he would have the fire containers around him. So it once so happened that he disappeared around. But Sai Baba immediately dipped his hand in a vessel which was burning. And he kept it for a while and suddenly removed the hand from the vessel. Disciples were wondering, what is this? Why did he do this? Why did he burn his hand? So they asked him after a while. They said, what is this? Why did you put your hand in that fire and why did you burn your hand? He said, I have no problem about my hand getting burnt. Because he had a transcendent consciousness. My hand is burnt. It is not burning me. So that's not a problem to me. But then why did I do it? Because one of my disciples in the vicinity here, his child fell in fire. His baby fell in fire. So I wanted to save the baby and that's why I put my hand in the fire and removed it. And the baby was saved there. This was testified later. So that was not in his karma to get this experience of burning one's own hand. That was not his part of prarabdha. But he took somebody's prarabdha and he did save that child from getting burnt and then dying perhaps. So these great people have this kind of powers because of their spiritual wisdom and spiritual attainment that they can take somebody else's karmas because they don't themselves suffer. Their bodies don't suffer. If you are having some body pain, I can't say, give me your body pain, I will take it because I don't suffer any pain. I will have to suffer the pain if I take your pain. But they don't have this corporeal consciousness. So they are not going to suffer by any pain to the body. So that was not a problem to Sai Baba to dip his hand in the fire and burn his hand. But it was to save the child. So this karma management comes. It will be quite understandable if you start understanding the levels of consciousness which a man can attain. And in higher attainment of level, so many things are possible, plausible, which are not even imaginable to our temporal mind, the mind which is encased in brain. No, it will not be logical, etc. And it will be fantasy perhaps even for us. But that is not true in the realm of karma. It's a gahana gatihi. So we do not know. Anyway, the thing is the karma management. The karma management to a saint is such a nature that he will also manage somebody else's karma. See, if I lose 100 rupees, I don't get a prick because I am a rich man and 100 rupees loss is not too much for me. But for somebody, 100 rupees is too much. Maybe for 3-4 days life, 3-4 days living. So, I can prevent loss of 100 rupees to that person by my power. And I can take the loss of the 100 rupees on me, myself, which is not a big problem, which doesn't dig anything in my mind. So, the karma management aspect is quite mysterious. And the more we are familiar with this karma philosophy, we will be starting to understand so many things which don't seem to be logical, cohesive, or acceptable to empirical mind. But yet, once we have that wisdom, we will understand it. Anyway, this karma management is such an important aspect, which comes to adhyatma sadhaka, adhyatma, adhyatmically evolved person. Enormous privileges are there, concessions are there, that they can manage karmas, not only of theirs, but even the karmas of others. If others are going to suffer, like in this example, that child was going to suffer, the parents would be losing the child itself, but he saved the child. Many times they take diseases of other people onto them. This is also part of experience, that some saints have taken diseases of their followers because they don't suffer anything corporeally. Even their psychological mind doesn't suffer, so they can take any sorrow of their devotee. So karma management is possible. It is not a fatalistic view that karma siddhanta is postulated in Oriental wisdom or Indian wisdom or Hindu wisdom. There's enormous insight that we must develop for karma. Okay.
So just one thing to clarify. So this aniyata vipaka karmashaya that we saw, which has three kinds of gati, either nasha or pradana karmaniya, avapagamanam or chiramavasthanam. So one aspect is the marvelous karma management that yogis of the high rank can do.
But at the same time, you get basis for moksha. Aniyataka karma, aniyata vipaka karmashaya can be managed, as you just now heard the three ways. This is how liberation is possible. Otherwise, you have endless heap of karmas and we are collecting karmas. So where is the chance to get liberated? No, it is possible because of the karma management. And aniyata vipaka karmashaya is best possible kind of body of karmas which can be managed. And that's how we can pave way for liberation. Okay.
So the clarification I was going to make is the one aspect of understanding this is the ability to manage karmas by the yogis of a high caliber, but the aniyata vipaka karmashe exists for everyone, and it is not only about karma management. It also is a way, as a principle, to explain how the contradictions of possible contradictions in the ordained rectification of contradictory karmas. So something like I said, may say, oh, this leads to a life of a tree, that leads to a life of a bird or whatever. So what happens of that? So one is, given that the karmashaya, the niyata vipaka gets classified into primary and secondary, the others that may not fit there can become the aniyata, and therefore they may either get destroyed or rendered impotent. For example, a bad fruit for a bad deed may get destroyed, as we'll see later, because a lot of preponderance of a certain type of good deeds, or it might even get postponed, which is the third gati, that says, okay, the particular three fruition pertaining to a certain other type of birth and life will come when that particular pradhana leads to that particular life form, and until then it will be suppressed. So this suppressing or mixing into another pradhana or getting destroyed opens the gate for karma management for the yogis, or it also operates on its own as part of the karma principle, and thereby explains the variety, the contradiction and the mysteriousness of the karmas as an adjunct to the main karmas, ekabhavika karmashaya, with its primary and secondary. So now we'll stop here. We'll continue on the same bhashya next time, because there is still slight elaboration on the three gatis done by Vyasa that still remain, and then rounding off our understanding of the karma siddhanta based on the previous sutra and this sutra. So today we'll stop here. Recite the shlokas on Guruji and then end this. Vaijnanikam pravaktritva asaneshu kalavidam योगाभ्यासे च तत्त्वज्ञं वन्देहं सुन्दरं गुरुं योगवृक्षो हि लोकेऽस्मिन् यत्प्रेरणेन वर्धितः योगाचार्यगुरो तुभ्यं सुन्दराय नमो नमः थैंक यू
नमस्ते थैंक यू वेरी मच